You can never forget that, you guys. You can never forget that. You have to make it a mantra, okay? If it's exercise, then do it 3 days a week. Understand that the work has to sell, okay? If the work is not selling, you know, there's a number of ways you can address that, but that is exercise, okay? That is the most important thing. And you're gonna have periods in your careers where some stuff sells well and other stuff does not, okay? And other stuff does not. And lest you think, going back to the exercise analogy, that Picasso didn't come off track a little bit. When he died, he had 45,000 unsold works in his inventory. 45,000, okay? What did Picasso understand? That you're gonna veer off the path every once in a while. The work is not gonna sell. It's not a death knell. It doesn't mean you're a crappy artist. You just gotta get back on track. And you always have to remind yourself that the work has to sell. The art must go out into the world, okay? Never forget that. It's so important. And I bring this up because all the time, I get all these questions on here about this and pricing and niche selection, how do I handle shipping and how do I handle international shipping? And then I'm like, have you gotten any international orders? Then what the hell are you working on? If you don't focus on moving the work, you are spending your time on the wrong thing. If the work is not selling, you've got other problems that you need to address. The good news is now we can get into the real nuts and bolts of pricing, okay? You have to have a range of pricing. Now this is a big umbrella with a bunch underneath it, and so I'm gonna come after it a couple of different ways. But here are the reasons that you need to have a range of pricing, okay? Your followers, your fans, your emails, your prospective buyers, buyers, collectors, they all fall into the socioeconomic bell curve, okay? Starts on one side with the low income folks. Then you have lower middle class, upper middle class, high net worth individuals, okay? It doesn't matter what shows and fairs you do. It doesn't matter what galleries you are, what part of the world you are, what your niche is. Your prospective fans, followers, buyers, all everything that I just mentioned falls onto that socioeconomic bell curve, okay? The smart entrepreneur knows this, okay? And if they wanna see the highest ROI, return on investment from their marketing activities, from doing shows, from whatever you're doing, okay? You have to have price points for everyone on that bell curve. There's a number of reasons to that. We're gonna get into it, but let's just talk about real numbers for a second, okay? You have to have prices under $100. You have to have prices from 100 to 1,000. You need prices well over 1,000. That is all it is generally. I argue you also need prices for several $1,000. And you know, if you feel like you're already on the high end of the scale and you're charging 10 or 15 or 20 grand for an original, you need to have one in there for $100,000, okay? Because when you understand the socioeconomic bell curve, you realize that yeah, you have to have something cheap at the low end of the deal to cater to those folks, but you also need something really high end, but the majority of your business is gonna fall into the middle of the bell curve, okay? You would be surprised how profoundly impactful and important this is when you look at your pricing this way. Not only that, you've got to have non-wall art as a part of your lineup, okay? Not everybody you market to, this is one of the most often made mistakes that I see, not everybody that you're marketing to, okay, needs wall art right now at this moment. Not everyone that your emails, your social media marketing, your art show, your whatever, okay, is exposed to is gonna have their hand up and say, I need art right now. In fact, the majority of them won't, okay? So if you don't have the lower price point and you don't have a non-wall art product that they can buy as a way of saying, I like you, I like what you're doing, I like what you're putting down creatively, you are gonna lose out on that sale and you're gonna lose out on that particular customer, okay? It is so important, I can't begin to tell you that. Now, the good news is, and we're gonna get into some teeth about examples about how you hit all these price points. It's less important how you hit the price points and how you develop the non-wall art product than it is in having them. You have a great deal of creativity, okay? You have a great deal of creativity. Now, there's only three ways to grow your business. And this is a fundamental truth. Again, you know, you don't get this unless you go to business school and specifically digital marketing school, really. None of which I've been to, by the way. There's only three ways to grow an art business, okay? There's only three ways. Number one, acquire new customers. That's where 95% of artists and photographers spend their time. Acquire new customers, acquire new customers, acquire new customers. Go out, do fairs, go do shows, do social media marketing, run Facebook ads, email marketing, whatever you're doing. all you just focus on acquiring customers. What almost no artists and photographers focus on is the second way to grow an art business, which is to increase your AOV. AOV stands for average order value. If I bought a canvas print from you for $200, my average order value is AOV. If you raise the price up to $250, the average order value is $250, so on and so forth. So that is the second way to grow a business, okay? The third way to grow an art business is to get your existing customers to come back and purchase again, okay? All three ways are significantly important. 90% of artists and photographers only work on the acquiring new customers. Yeah, they send some emails out, but they don't do anywhere near enough initiatives to work on existing customers. And one of the things that I say fundamentally, if you've been following what we talk about here for any length of time, is understand another truth. The easiest customer to get is the one that you already have. It is the one that has already purchased something. It is why I often say one of the most important metrics in an art or photography business is the size and health of a collector list. A collector list is defined as the number of people that have purchased work from you before, and you market to those people in perpetuity, and you treat them very specially. Why? Because the easiest customer to get is the one that you already have. Okay, so that covers the three ways to grow an art business. Now let's give this whole thing some teeth so that we can sort of focus on the product lineup that you would need to achieve something like this. And it should be noted that, like a lot of truths, you know, we're in the truths of pricing section. You guys, it's all just maths. It's just maths. It's a mathematical equation, okay? There is no room for emotion in this whatsoever. It is just maths, and when you understand that, you boil the emotion out of it, you start working on creating these price points, and it is just a formula. It's just a formula that you need to achieve. Now, let me talk about recommended product ranges to achieve everything that I've just laid out. On the low end, the low range, $0 to $100, or, you know, perhaps $150 now with inflation. I mean, I live in California. The gas prices here are insane. Anyway, on the low end, I really, really like merchandise, okay? I don't really care what the merchandise is. One of the things that we do at Art Storefronts is offer all of these various different things. Calendars and mugs and cell phone cases and yoga mats and coasters. We have all these various different products. And a lot of artists to me are like, merch, that stuff's chintzy, that stuff's cheap, I don't care about that. Go ahead and let me know, one of you, the last time you went into a museum that didn't have a gift shop. I'll wait. They all do for a reason, okay? Because it's just maths. It's a mathematical equation, you know? The museum knows that if they want to earn the extra revenue, they'd better have a product for the low end of the socioeconomic scale so that folks can buy something, okay? And they can acquire a customer. It is no different, okay? It is no different than it is for you guys, right? So I like merch. I don't care which merch pieces you have. I have got my favorites. You might have your favorites. I'm not suggesting any in any draconian fashion. Do you? Maybe they're little small creations, whatever they are. You can also, to a certain extent, achieve it with inexpensive paper prints and smaller metal prints. But again, that's all wall art. You have to have the non-wall art, okay? For the mid-range, and we're going to say $100 to $1,000 to keep this simple, you have to have a combination of open editions, which are prints. You have to have limited editions, okay? And then you need to have originals, right? And in the mid-range, the $100 to $1,000 range, the combination of open edition prints, and open edition means you'll sell 1,000 of them. They're not limited. They're not numbered. Limited edition just means 1 of 10, 1 of 5, 1 of 20, okay? But the open edition prints handle the low end of that scale. Oftentimes the limited edition prints handle the higher end of that scale, and then it can even dip in over 1,000. And then on top of that, you have the originals. If you're a photographer, obviously you're not gonna have an original, so you need to get a little bit more creative, okay, in terms of how you do it. You special metal prints or special acrylic prints, 1 of 4, right? In various different fashions like that. That's how you achieve the entire scale from one end to another. And when you do, you start to realize the true power of just setting up this range. It solves all of your pricing conundrums. It fixes all of it because you've got your low-end stuff, you've got your mid-range stuff, and then you've got your high-end stuff, right? That's what it does. It just works out. And it's, you know, funny because earlier in my career, many moons ago, I owned a furniture business, okay? And one of the product categories we had were mattresses. And you would advertise this crappy mattress. Okay, I'm not proud of this, but full disclosure, I like to have integrity. The mattress you advertised, if it sold, you would lose $150. And so we like took it out in back of the warehouse and like ran it over 15 times. So it was the most terrible thing ever. And so people would come in on the ad and I would have all the mattresses lined up in this long, skinny warehouse from the very high end to the very low end, okay? That crappy one. And the crappy one was down on the floor and all the rest of them were up on like, you know, normal bed frames. And what people do is they would come in, they would go all the way to the one that was advertised and they would anchor themselves to that as the low end. And then they would walk all the way to the high end and they would look at the giant memory foam triple pillow top, could barely get normal sheets on it, giant monstrosity. And they would anchor on that one at the high end, okay? And then you know what they would do? They would start focusing on the ones in the middle and they would inevitably pick one in the middle. 80% would, 90% would. But guess what? Every once in a while, somebody would buy the crappy one, which would suck because I'd have to give it to them and then go run over another one with a car. But oftentimes, too, some people would go and buy the high-end one, okay? And it wouldn't happen every single solitary time, but that's just the bell curve illustrated in mattresses, right? That's the bell curve that you guys need to have with your art and product lineup. It's that simple. It's quite literally that simple to achieve. And once you do, that one alone, okay, knocks out, I would say, 90% of the pricing conundrums that you might have. You're like, okay, number one, the work must sell. If it's not selling, I've got other problems. The work's either not good enough or it is not a product the market wants, okay? I need to try something different. The work must sell. And if it sells cheap at first, that's okay. That's okay, right? But the work must sell. Then, once you understand that pricing range, as I just laid it out, and you put that into practice, your pricing conundrums are over. They're done, okay? So you've got something for all of those various different ranges. The prices sort of just set themselves as a result of it. Next, I want to pivot to negotiation, okay? To negotiate or not. Hot button topic, this one, right? Hot button topic, this one. And hold on, I got to send my wife a message really quick. Whatever she'll get. I see so many people saying, negotiate. Are you out of your mind? Don't negotiate. You should never negotiate. It is going to cheapen the value of your work, okay? I don't know where anyone got that nonsense thing pounded into their head. Everyone negotiates, okay? You need to sell. There are certain people that will not buy unless they can negotiate because that's how they're wired or that's how they were brought up culturally. Never forget, your work must go out into the world, okay? Negotiation gets you there, then you need to do it. End of section, really. But more broadly, what do we all hear on a regular basis is like artists and photographers? We hear about the stuff that sell at Christie's or the stuff that sell at Sotheby's for list price or over list price. Do you know what we never hear about? The other 99% that sells with negotiation every single solitary time. The most opaque institutions in this country or art galleries, okay? They don't tell you who's buying, they don't tell you what price, and there's a reason. Because they are negotiating so significantly, it's mind-boggling, okay? The more expensive a piece, the more this happens. At the higher end of the scale, it is absolutely ridiculous. Like pieces over $20,000, the sheer amount of negotiation. High net worth individuals, okay? The ones that are not in the inheritance business aside, did not get that way by paying retail for anything ever, okay? Negotiation is a part of absolutely everything. And when you understand that, okay, when you come to terms with that, you can just take a deep breath and you're like, okay, then I can leverage this, okay? I can leverage the fact that people want to negotiate, that people will only buy when they get a deal, and I can use it to my advantage, okay? I could use it to my advantage. It's a weapon in my arsenal that was going to allow me to sell more art, which gets us into markups, okay? Markups is a critically, critically important part of this. And understanding markups is less straightforward, of course, on originals than it is on prints, okay? So I'm going to isolate this whole thing to prints. And I should also mention that, sorry, I have to send a message to my wife. Can I get keys? On the low end of the scale, okay, on your zero to $100, am I going to go to Target this afternoon and pick some Legos off the shelf and try to negotiate them down? No, I'm not, okay? So you don't need to negotiate on the lower end of the scale. So don't focus on that part of it. But the mid end to the high end, okay, that's where we do our negotiation, and that's where markups come in, okay? You take the price of the print to you and you mark it up at a minimum of 250%, okay? You can go 250, you can go 350, you can go 450, you can go 550, 650, 750 even if you have the demand, if the work is selling. So let's give this some real numbers and understand negotiation, okay? We could do five of these sessions on negotiation. There's so much nuance to it. But the good news is there's a Cliff Notes, and there is a Cliff Notes for artists, and it's very, very simple. Yes, you can negotiate. The only rule is just this. You never, ever negotiate down without getting something else in return, okay? You never negotiate down without getting something else in return, okay? And the simplest way, I find that the easiest way to do that is you get creative. So let's put this whole entire thing together. I've got another example from a previous life that could use here too. You buy a metal print for $100. You mark it up 250%. It's $350 purchase price now. That thing is hanging in your booth at an art fair. Somebody comes in and they're like, "Hey, Patrick, I love this print. How much are you asking for it?" "Yeah, it's $350. It's a little bit out of my budget. Are you willing to negotiate on it? Would you take 300? What most people do are they're like, "Yeah, of course I would take 300. Take it. Please take it. Go." No, no. You get something in return. And this is where it allows you to get creative. "You know what? I normally don't negotiate, but my car was kind of full driving to the show in the first place, and I would really like to get the space back. So if you take it today, I'll let it go for $300. Will you take it today?" "Shut up." "Yeah, I will take it today." So I just inserted something in there that I got that made me negotiate down without giving something up for free. Instead of negotiating for free, I gave them, "Will you take it today?" They acquiesced to, "Will we take it today?" The negotiation, I gave something up and they gave something up. You can insert whatever you want in there. "Will you take it today?" Right? Will you take two of them? Whatever you want. But when you negotiate, get something back in return. Okay? Get something back in return. When you find that you do this, not only does it work from a business standpoint, they won't try to actually grind you down again, but it also makes you feel better psychologically. It will enhance your sense of net worth, you'll find, after you've done it, where you didn't just buckle, right? You didn't just fade away right away. And it is one of these just secret little tactics and techniques. I used to be a property manager back in the day. I'm like Jamaican. I've had so many jobs, I can't even get to tell you. And I would rent houses, right? And if I wanted to rent the house for $3,000, I would raise the price to $3,400. I would wait until I find someone that I knew liked it, and maybe they would have some things that they would want to get fixed, this, that, or the other. You know, I would take this place if I did this or if I did that. Well, tell you what. I was really looking for a year lease. If you were willing to do a year lease, I'll give it to you for that price. I was always going to do a year lease, right? And I would just drop the price, and they would say, "Okay, I'm going to take the year lease." So you can insert so many various different creative things in there. But if you just know that principle of negotiation when you're selling your art, you will win. You will win. It's that simple. Try it the next time you're in a negotiation. People will respect you more when they feel like they got something out of it. It's just a thing. That covers negotiation. Let's get into sales. And an important thing that I went over there was the markups. Okay, out. Sorry, guys, 1 second. You know that week in between when school gets out and the summer camps start next week? Yeah, not awesome. Not awesome in my household. It's a zoo over here. Anyway, markups are fundamentally important in terms of negotiation, and markups are even more important in terms of sales, okay? Every artist, every photographer needs to be running sales. Now, are there some products out there that don't? Yeah, there are. The only two that I'm aware of are Louis Vuitton and Tiffany's. Those are the only two that I know that don't discount. And guess what? They just merged, so now it's one company. Now, there's a couple other brands here or there that I know don't ever discount under any circumstances, but let me just tell you, you better have a pretty damn solid brand ID if you think you're going to pull that off. Most of you don't. You have to run sales. Sales is just maths. Like the pricing range is just maths, okay? Sales are just a psychological equation, okay? Very succinctly, human beings need a discount plus scarcity to take action. Real world example, the discount is 15% off. The scarcity is ends at midnight. And what you get as a result of that is you get human beings taking action. Once you understand that this is fundamental to making sales, okay, to getting human beings taking action, you realize, yes, I need to be running sales. Yes, I need to get some practice running sales. The more sales I run, probably the better my business will do, okay? And once you understand that, you understand why we mark things up 250%. Because if they're marked up 250% and you have a 10% off or a 15% off or a 20% off sale, it's not going to kill you. It's not going to kill your margins because you're already marked up that high. You're already marked up that high. So look, sales have been used for centuries and centuries and centuries to get human beings to take action. I argue that all of you guys need to be running them. They're very, very important, okay? So when you combine the truths, the work must go out into the world. It has to sell. The transaction has to happen. When you combine the range of pricing, when you can, everything that that entails, right? The three ways to grow an art business. When you combine negotiation, when you combine sales, you no longer have a pricing problem. Your pricing problem is sorted. You just cruise along with that pricing matrix, with that pricing analysis that I have, and you make tiny little course corrections as you go, and you realize that pricing is what's called a reversible decision, okay? We always want to ask ourselves in our business, is this a reversible decision or not, okay? A reversible decision, you can change your mind and go back. You could be at $1,000 in original tomorrow, $10,000 on Friday, and back down to $1,000 next Friday. No one would even know. No one would even say anything. It's a completely reversible decision. So you course correct as you go. And guess what? For some of you, you might not ever have to change pricing from what I just outlined. Because let me tell you, you might just be right in the range you're in. And volume is a thing. So all you have to do is get that art, get that photography in front of more eyeballs. You do that, the volume increases, and the next thing you know, you have a really, really healthy business. That is where it all starts. That is the way to solve pricing. That is the thing that no one ever talks about and no one ever teaches. And that's it. If you just remember those truths, that's the ball game, and it becomes that simple. And instead of worrying about any other type of pricing conundrums or questions, if you start with this, if you start with that matrix, if you start with those truths, all of it just takes care of itself. All of it just takes care of itself. It is sorted, right? It is sorted. And Butch asked in the chat about shipping. Shipping is an interesting one. Thank God, you guys, art has not been Amazonified, meaning there is not an expectation in this market that if you buy wall art, you get free shipping. Doesn't exist. Thank God for that. I hope Amazon doesn't screw that one up. So you sell the piece, the buyer pays shipping after the fact. Very, very easy to do. 90%, 95% of our customers do it that way. Some elect to do free shipping, and they just raise their markup percentage to accommodate for that. And on some customers, they'll take a bath on the shipping, and some customers will live close, and they'll make a couple of bucks, and in the end, it all shakes out. So that's it. That covers the shipping side of it, Butch. But that is my pricing rant. Haven't heard one like that, though, have you? Right? It's a really, really creative way to approach it, and it's just not something that most people do. What, you know what artists do? Ruminate on it, and contemplate it, and get terrified about it. And 3 months down the line, they haven't done a single bit of marketing. All they talked about pricing. You know what they haven't done? The work must sell. It must go out into the world. They don't have the pricing range. They're not negotiating, and they're not running sales. You fix that, you fix pretty much the entire business. It will get going. It will get cranking. So that's my rant on pricing. We can open it up for Q&A. How do we go about doing that? At the bottom, well, if you're one of the brave ones with your camera on, all you have to do is raise your hand. I'll be like, okay, I know they got a question. And I can unmute you. We can talk about whatever. You can ask about the pricing. You can ask about anything that we do at Art Storefronts. We got a really cool thing that I can show in a second that has to do with Instagram Reels. I'm all over Instagram Reels right now. So important for artists. But anyway, we can talk about any of that. So if you're on video, you have a question, raise your hand. For everyone else, there's this little smiley face, and it says reactions, and there's like a little plus sign on it. And if you click that, that gives you the ability to raise your hand digitally speaking. You can see how I kind of did it in my little window there. Let somebody know, that you have a question. I can unmute you, and you can get going. If you don't want to turn your camera on, you don't have to turn your camera on, okay? I hate being on video. This is my job. Otherwise, you would never see me. I have a face for radio. So you can ask via audio if you're so inclined. You can throw questions into the chat, and we always just need a brave one. Oh, yeah, and if you're one of the ones that's watching on YouTube or Facebook or any of the other ones, I see your questions too. Thank you, Anita. Thank you, Abstract Art Johannan. Johannan. I think it's Johannan. Anyway, who's going to be the brave one? All it takes is one. I just need one. Bridget, I saw it. Oh, see, Laura. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about that little. I see you. Let's do this. You need to unmute. You need to unmute, my dear. There's the mic icon, lower left-hand corner.
Is that okay?
Now I gotcha.
Okay. My question is, mm-hmm. can you use photographs from the phone, an iPhone?
Yes.
Or do you have to, like, hire a photographer?
Yes. So the question you're really asking is, will the photographs that I take from my iPhone of my art be high enough resolution to reproduce prints?
Yes.
They will and they can, but it's sort of suboptimal because the way the software works, you upload the image, it gets analyzed mm-hmm. by a little program, and it says, okay, Laura, this is as big as you can go with that photo, right? And okay. the iPhone photography won't quite go as big as some of the bigger stuff. But the good mm-hmm. news is you don't want to do it anyway. You don't want to do it anyway. There is a beautiful thing called Craigslist. You put a post on Craigslist and you say, looking for a photographer that has experience in the gig section.
Oh.
Looking for a photographer that has experience in photographing fine art will come to my house and shoot all of it in my garage. Please only, not kidding, write this part down. Please only respond if you have experience photographing fine art and can send me links. And then you know what you do? Nothing. Do not look at any of the emails coming in because you will get approximately 75 of them. After you have 75 of them, there are more photographers on Craigslist than you could even imagine. After you go through the 75 of them, okay, what you'll want to do is see the one that says, hey, Laura, not only have I photographed fine art before, I've done it 15 times. Here's some links of the ones that I've done. And then you're like, oh, that's my guy. That's my gal. Get him over here and then let them do it. And it shouldn't even be that expensive. Like, if you have enough pieces, it's sometimes they only charge like $35, $40, and there's $25 depending on what part of the country you're in.
Thank you.
Yep. Done and done. I'm full of tricks, Laura. Full of tricks like that. Yeah. That's an important one. That's a really, really important one. Because you might as well just get it done and be done with it. And then, you know, somebody wants to buy the original and you don't have it photographed. And you're like, wait, let me go get a photograph. No. Just get it done, right? Do them in batches and get that going. Daniel in the chat is asking, how much do you need to make to live in a year? I would ask, well, I can't answer that question. Crystal ball question. I have no idea. Everyone's different. How many paintings, photos, art pieces can you produce? That's your price. Okay, I totally don't understand what's going on here, Daniel. Merch is extra money, including costs, and number one. Yeah, you might need to clarify that in the chat. I don't fully understand. But who else, guys? Questions? Laura was brave. Normally all it takes is one, and then somebody else is ready to step up. Either use the little raise hand thing here, reactions, okay, Daniel's saying that's how you price your work. I get it. See, okay, Carolyn, that's what I'm talking about. All it takes is a couple brave souls. You'll need to unmute, Carolyn. I'll let you know when you get it. Yep, gotcha.
Okay, there we go. Hi.
Hi.
This is great. Thank you so much, Patrick.
That's my pleasure. I love doing it.
Yeah, I'm good. It shows. Say, the photos I have are in a book,
mm-hmm.
and of 43 photos, and maybe 10 of them are very good for showing. So is my price point going to change by the varying sizes of the prints that I offer?
Yes. Yes, it would change
okay.
via size, it would change via media type in some circumstances, and then obviously it would change again when you decide to do limited edition ones.
Well, so I'm making the print and sending it.
Yeah, if you did it on your own, yes. I mean, if you signed up with us, we do all that for you.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We have to talk.
Oh, I like it, Carolyn. I like it. Yeah, yes, we do. And wait a minute. Were you the birthday girl? Happy birthday to you, too. It's your birthday. It says it back there.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Congrats.
Thank you.
Yeah, we can help you out there. It's no problem at all. All you have to do is go to our website and click one of the 9 million buttons that say demo, and then they'll walk you through everything and the pricing and the plans. Or you don't even have to do that. If you want, I can have them reach out. I muted you again, though, so I got to see if that's what you want me to do. You'll have to hit your mic icon again, Carolyn.
Okay. Well, let me go to the website and try the demo first and then see how that sits with me.
Wonderful.
And if I still have questions, I'll get in touch. And I'll probably just get in touch anyway, Patrick.
Well, I like it. I like it, Carolyn. Cooking with gas. Thanks. All right. Who else, guys? Questions? Yep. Daniel, I got you.
Unmute. Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah. The people make this pricing thing so difficult, and it's really not. How much do you need to make? How much can you produce? That's your price. And all your costs have to be added into number one to how much do you need to make. Once you have that price, then you can vary from that. Mm-hmm. That means we have to produce more. But the thing I like about your system is that you have the option to merch.
Yeah.
That additional stuff that you can do that adds to that fee. But you're only working your price based on what you actually produce as your primary product. And every other product, like you mentioned with Picasso, sketches, preliminary prints, paintings, and stuff like that, that's extra money.
That's right. That's right. And print on demand is such a blessing for you guys, like to not having to keep inventory for no order minimums. Like, oh, it's a godsend. It's a godsend, right?
You handle the shipping too, right? I mean, your organization.
What? Say it again.
You handle the shipping too.
Oh yeah, 100% of it. And you even that's like, you know, it's one of the awesome parts of how we work and how the print industry works at large, is and also one of the sad ones, right? Because, you know, I've essentially been in this industry since the very first G Clay happened, right? The very first inkjet printer ripped off a print, right? From lithograph serigraphy, I can never say that right. Serigraphy to the first inkjet printers. And back then, you had this whole like nationwide network of these tiny little printers, right? Like mom and pop shops, individuals, and craftsmanship was totally the thing. And, you know, they would cater to it and provide all the service. And that was just an awesome, awesome way to go about it. Well, the problem is that those days are over, okay? Mm-hmm. Those days are over because the big boys that buy ink by the barrel have rolled all those small guys up and they can't compete anymore. Now, bummer, because I like the small mom and pop shop, you know? But the interesting thing about it and the dirty little secret about the shipping that no one talks about, our partner for prints on the West Coast is Bay Photo. Our partner for prints on the East Coast is Graphic Dimensions. You can use either one, it doesn't matter. But because they're, you know, $35-$50 million a year businesses, I'm a customer. I place an order on your site. Everything gets taken care of. You know, the order gets printed. The order gets boxed. Your logo goes on the side of the box. You don't touch anything. It arrives at the customer, and the thing's damaged. Ordinarily, that's a big headache for you, right? Now, because you're partnered with these big guys, what happens is they don't even ask anything. Don't ship it back to me. I don't need to know. I don't want to know. I don't care. A new one's on the way. Because it's more of a hassle and a cost for them to even get one coming back. Mm-hmm. And so the sheer amount, I mean, the damage doesn't happen all that often, but the sheer amount of customer service headaches that eliminates is just fantastic. You know, it's just fantastic.
2018, I ordered 15 cards, Christmas cards of a painting I did at a brand with Christmas lights on it,
mm-hmm.
from Vista Print.
Yeah.
They sent me also a pillow. It was wrong. Before I could get the pillow sent back to them, they sent me a second pillow and a third pillow that was correct.
Yeah, they just don't care.
I got three pillows and 150 cards.
Yeah, they just don't care. There's like a...
They don't care.
I have a Vespa, you know, and there's like a scooter and there's one Vespa shop. Yeah. And Daniel, I'm going to mute you because your mic is not plugged in all the way and it just kind of goes in and out, in and out. It's cutting out. Anyway, the Vespa, I ordered a helmet and it was expensive and the helmet was damaged and they didn't even care. They didn't even send it back. They just sent me a new one. I was like, oh my gosh, they're so big. They just don't even care. All right, Lewis, go ahead. Oh, your mic's not working. Great. Is that what you said? You got to unmute first, Lewis. Let's at least see. Click the microphone icon, bottom left-hand corner. Yep.
Yeah, it's not going to work, I don't believe.
No, it's working great.
Oh, yeah. Great. You can actually hear me?
Yeah, totally hear you.
Oh, what about that? Well, you had mentioned earlier about a gentleman that didn't have a whole lot of tech savvy, mm-hmm. and I am not highly technical. Mm-hmm. I guess my question is, how much do you think we need for our storefronts to really make it work for us?
In terms of technical sophistication, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So my contention is, and again, I base this on the years and years and years I've been doing this and all the various different conversations I've had. My firm belief, and I didn't get into this, is the number of artists and photographers making something resembling a decent living through the gallery model, the retail gallery model, what you guys have all been sold as the panacea your entire career, is kind of like the number the number of people from our high school that we know that went to the professional sports, NBA, MLB. It's almost none, right? And so I think that's a really bad way to go. Now, the next best way to do it is the show and fair circuit. And I think that is totally a viable way to grow an art business in today's day and age. But that's really hard. It's hard on the body. It's driving, the boost setups, all the rest of it. So the third way, which is totally viable, totally incredible, and far surpasses the other two, is by selling direct on your website, by marketing consistently. And so I feel like once you know that, nothing is going to change foreseeable. Like, I talk to so many people that are on so many different marketplaces too, Fine Art America, Etsy, Saatchi, any of them, doesn't matter. No one's making any money doing that. Like, a couple of bucks here or there, but it's nothing resembling a career. So my contention is the only way to do it is selling direct, and the only way to do it is to learn how to do these things technologically and how to do them digitally. The good news is it's like anything else. How do you get to Carnegie Hall? You practice. So if you came in on the low end of the tech scale, is your first 1 or 2 years going to be fun? No, it's going to suck. You're going to hate it. You're going to lose some hair. But I don't know what the alternative is. You have to learn it. You have to learn it. You have to be able to do it, and you have to start doing it consistently, because I don't know how the hell else you make it in this business. I honestly don't. So I think if you can play that game in your mind and say, I'm not going to quit and I'm going to be willing to do it, you're great. The good news is you got a lot of company. Artists by nature are oftentimes Luddites. I say it lovingly, right? And so you all have to learn how to do this. And the good news, this is what we do. We teach you all day long, and you're going through it not alone, but with a bunch of people that are like, in your peer group, so to speak. So that's a really, really important aspect of it.
Well, good. Excellent. I appreciate that.
Yeah. But don't let anyone sugarcoat it for you. First couple of years, going to suck. But it's like anything else. Like, we give you a calendar on what to do 365 days a year. And on the calendar, there's beginner, intermediate, and advanced, right? And in the beginning, you just do what you can. You don't let it destroy you. You just do what you can. But I mean, honestly, if I move the screen share into like our internal Facebook group or our internal Discord group, we have this Discord server, and showed you some of the complaints, you would be like, that's going to be me. 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 What we do differently, though, is we don't just teach you. We do the other part of the equation. If you were on for my pricing rant, I talked about the business side and the psychological side, right? Growing an art business and making it has the marketing side and learning all of it. And then it has the accountability side, because what all artists and photographers do is they treat their marketing like a New Year's resolution. They're going to the gym 4 days a week in January. March comes along and they haven't been once all month, right? So we have a support structure in place that is a combination of bribery, extortion, cajoling, support, group support, customer groups. Like it takes literally every single solitary amount of thing to get people to push through the normal quitting points of learning how to do this. Once they do, they're on the path. And my point remains, you've got multiple decades left to get this right. So can you go through a couple years of pain to get there? Yeah, you can if you want it bad enough, right? The 2 years means nothing in 20, and then all of a sudden you have a business where you don't have to leave your house, and you're running live art shows, and you're doing the sales, and you're doing everything that we recommend, and the business is growing year after year after year. That's the ballgame.
Excellent. Well, that's my goal. I would love it. I'm retired, so I've got the time to put into it.
Mm-hmm.
So, good.
But the case in point, you're retired, And you're not talking about not doing this. You can't stop doing it. It's all you want to do. It's what you've been contemplating doing, working all those years. And I think, you know, fundamentally, it's like, you know, my generation is like obsessed with aging, right? And tracking everything in your body and diet and living as long as you can. And like one of the most important things for like a long life is having purpose, right? And I've seen so many of my friends' dads are retired and didn't have anything to do, right? And then like had to come up with some sort of hobby. But when you have like a business where you can make forward progress and you can literally do it till the day you die, it's this rad thing about being an artist. It's a rad thing about being a creator.
Yeah.
You know, it'll keep you motivated, keep you moving forward, give you purpose for the rest of your life, which is not to say you wouldn't have that otherwise. But I'm just saying this gives you, you know, an additional one. Everyone's a little bit different, but it's awesome. I think it's one of the fascinating things about what you guys do, the way your brains are wired.
Yeah, I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you, Patrick. Yeah. I appreciate that. That's very helpful.
Yeah. Thanks, Liz. Okay, guys, who else? Questions? And then I can talk to you about like one extra special thing that we have going on right now too, which is kind of fun. But just out of curiosity, I don't want to be, you know, how many of you guys with the cameras on, hands up or not hands up, even know what an Instagram reel is or have ever created one? Oh, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. I'm impressed by that. I'm impressed by that. So, oh man, this could be a whole nother rant. I'm going to give you the shortened version. Okay. The shortened version. I have to do this in like 3 minutes. Headline first. Instagram, without question, is the single solitary most important social media platform to sell art or photography. It's not even up for debate. Okay. Secondarily is Facebook. None of the other ones even matter. It's Instagram and then Facebook. Anyone that tells you anything differently than that is a unicorn or is lying. Okay. I've got 6,700 customers and I'm able to look at all of their data. I look at the ones that sell and then I look at the marketing sources. Okay. If anyone else tries to bullshit me about TikTok again, I will show up pistols at dawn in their front doorstep, right? Or YouTube or any of the rest of them. There are unicorn situations, but the important thing that you understand is that Instagram is the most important platform. Makes sense, right? It is a visual search engine. What do you guys do? Create beautiful visual things. So that's number one. Number two, as a result of competition, okay, Meta, it's now called Meta. Meta owns Facebook, Meta owns Instagram. Early on in social media days, Mark Zuckerberg had Facebook, and Facebook was working awesome, okay? And back then, I would follow somebody on Facebook, you would follow me, we would see 100% of each other's posts. It was the glory days. That was amazing, right? Then Facebook got enough users that they didn't need us to keep growing anymore, and they're like, guess what? Now your fans are going to see 2%. And the only way you're going to get that back is if you pay me money in the form of ads. That, up until this current moment in time, has been the social contract of social media, okay? You do all this work on rented land to get people to follow you, and then none of them even see it, okay? That's infuriating. Then, as Facebook was humming along, this new business came around, and it's called Instagram, and all of these users, especially the young kids, history repeats itself in social media now. All the young kids were leaving Facebook and starting Instagram accounts, and Facebook was like, oh my God, this is terrifying. We need to do something. So immediately, you know, giant bags of cash. Instagram said yes. Okay. Instagram said yes. So Facebook dodged the first bullet and they learned a lesson. When the new kid on the block comes and all the kids are fleeing the platform, go buy the thing. History repeated itself again. This time it was called Snapchat. Snapchat had this killer feature called Stories that disappeared after 24 hours. Mark Zuckerberg drove the Brinks truck up to the Snapchat guy's house, opened it up, went to the bag of cash, and the guy said, get off my lawn. I'm not selling, right? Zuckerberg went home and he's like, oh my goodness, what am I gonna do? And then he's like, wait a minute, I already have all the eyeballs. I already have all the attention. And then he went into the engineering room in his office and he's like, guys, copy that feature verbatim. And what did they do? They created Instagram Stories. The feature was copied verbatim, okay? Beautifully. So Zuckerberg learned a lesson, and everyone else in social media land learned a lesson too. If you have the attention already, if you have the eyeballs, i.e. all the daily active users, are called DAOs, daily active users, you can do whatever the hell you want because you have the currency of the land. Enter a new entity on the market. It used to be called Musical.ly. It was owned by a Chinese company, and then it was bought by a company called ByteDance and turned to a brand called TikTok. Now, truth, okay, Zuckerberg did try to buy this one, but he tried to buy this one. He didn't learn his lesson. No, he tried to buy this one because Facebook was banned in China and this one wasn't. They told him, no way, you're not getting another one. They came out, TikTok, with this format of short form little videos that is just destroying Facebook and Instagram right now. All the young kids are flocking to it, okay? So now Instagram is at war with TikTok for users, okay? And what they've decided to do to win this war is break the social contract. And again, the social contract on the social media sites is, if you get followers, the followers will see what you post, but no one else. There's no free ride, there's no free lunch. Now, with Instagram Reels, because Instagram is so terrified about TikTok, if you create Reels on Instagram, okay, and I'll find one here quickly. Is that one? Looks like one. Oh, no, it's a sponsored message. That's not it. Oh, it is. This is real. So, it's a ad. Hold on. I gotta get one. No. Yeah, this is one. So here they are. They have audio. They don't have audio, right? But what essentially happens here is when you create these, and there's a number of different ways to do them. It's beyond the subject of today's message. Instagram will now show these to people that do not follow you. Okay, so let's say Daniel has 500 followers on Instagram. He could create a reel that's seen by 3,500 people. And what's happening is because Instagram is so terrified of TikTok that they're willing to give you this free attention to just keep people on their platform. Okay, and this is one of the most fundamental shifts that I have seen in social media marketing landscape ever. Our customers are having some of the highest level of success, by which I mean, yes, making sales, but also growing their Instagram following so significantly, I can't even begin to tell you. And you'll go onto people's profiles, and it's like, if you go onto a profile, you can look at their followers and then go to the Reels tab, and you'll be able to see videos on here that have 10x the number of views that they do have followers. Now, views is largely a BS metric and it's super fakeable in some capacities, but it's somewhat true. But it doesn't matter. The success that you're seeing right now is incredible. Now, I know that most of you are not super sophisticated in social media. You haven't been doing social media marketing for a long time. What I'm telling you is the opportunity and time right now to start out with 5 followers and create something, okay? You have the potential for that to be seen by thousands of people starting today with 5 followers. That's never existed before without spending a whole lot of money. So Reels fundamentally are one of the most exciting, the most compelling things that you can be creating. It's one of the things that we teach. But in addition to that, one of the fun things, and don't take this as a sales pitch, okay? If you just found out about us, wonderful. We're not going anywhere. We're going to be around. But if you've, oftentimes there's people on here that have known about us for a while or like contemplating, should I sign up or not sign up? Look what I awesomely have made for you. I, myself, my team, not just me. But as an incentive to sign up this week for anybody that does, we have created, not that one, a Reels Kickstart bonus. So I think the cutoff for this is on Tuesday. But for anyone that signs up, we will make 4 Reels for you. And look at how cool this is. So the first one is we have one of our designers that does like motion graphics. And this is a video that you'll put on the end of your Instagram Reels, okay? That is like a logo animation. I gotta turn the volume so we can hear. Ooh, cool. So I actually saw her in my feed. Let's see if I can go back. So she's Kelly. There, you see it on the screen? I gotta get that down. So there's Kelly, our actual customer, using this one that we made for her in an actual reel. And it's just a really, really cool way to look professional. Here's another one I can show. They're just fun. But you use them at the end of your actual reel. The way that it works is like, you know, kind of like you make a photo collage. When you make a reel, you can insert various different video clips. So you put this on the end. We'll also make one for free. Sorry. That shows off the wall preview tool on your website. And so this is a feature that we have on our website, and it allows customers to visualize your art on their walls, move it around, do all this cool stuff, change colors, change room type. So we make one like that that lets people know that you have this amazing feature. We also make you some jazzy slideshows, like kind of like this one. So we'll make you one of those, and we'll make you one of these. And obviously this would be with your logo and your art and everything else, but this one's really cool for like photographers especially, but artists too that use color. And we have a couple of different music selections and everything else to try and get it, you know, more on your brand. But that's an incentive. If you sign up between now and Tuesday, all you have to do is request a demo. And if you sign up by Tuesday, you get that. But it's just sort of some of the fun stuff that we're doing to really get customers going and getting them fired up. But you guys all need to learn how to use Reels. No, Sky, that's the beauty of Reels. With Reels, Instagram has the entire music library there, and you can use hit songs. They don't even care. They've licensed all the music. And so you're essentially, you know, it's absolutely crazy. And I should do this because I can see the looks on some of your guys' faces. You're like, what the hell is this guy talking about? So let me show you. This is the easiest way to think about it. TV is over. TV is dead. TV is going to die with us. The people that sit down on the couch at the end of the day and they're like, I just want to be entertained by the boob tube, turn it on, don't make me think, is over. Now, you know, the younger generation especially, but they're converting large swaths of the 30s, the 40s, and even the 50s. What these folks do is they come on and they get into this Reels experience and they sit down and they just watch.
Losing is how you win later.
Come my day. Now, once you understand the TV part is when you can understand, just like TV, okay, on these there are channels. And there are channels that are driven by search intent, and there are channels that are driven algorithmically. And now let me explain it, okay? So let's say that your jam is, and I've got it, landscape photography, right? That's what you do. That's what I'm really interested in. I really like landscape photography. So I'll come in here and I'll search landscape photography, and all I have to do is do this one time, and I will now be on the landscape photography channel, okay? And I'm on my couch like I used to be watching TV, except now I'm just watching various different slideshows and videos of landscape photography. What I'm doing in the background is telling Instagram, I am very interested in landscape photography. This one's not really living up to it too well because it's a bunch of videos of tractors. What I'm interested in is landscape photography. And now the next time I come into the app, it's going to show me more and more and more and more of these folks, right? And do you notice how there's a little follow button on top of every single solitary one of them? If I like what I saw, all I have to do is click follow, and I'm now following that person. That is the technology that allows you to get a ton of followers very quickly without a lot of work. Landscape photography is too broad of a tag, I realize. But the point is that it's gone from, you know, for those of us that are super old school, you know, the three major channels, right, to all those cable channels, to now a million different channels, as if flipping channels isn't annoying enough as is, and now the algorithm will just serve it up for you. And if you've never experienced these things at all, I highly recommend you get on Instagram and experience them. And by the way, you remember when I said they all copy each other now? This is Instagram, okay? Okay, I clicked out of that. You already saw that. Not that one, I was making another one for TikTok. Did you even know I was in a different application? They've copied each other verbatim. Every single solitary aspect of it, even the button placement. This is TikTok's product, which is super annoying. I don't trust them. Chinese owned, dangerous. But YouTube, okay, has this thing called Shorts, and of course, when I'm in display mode, you're not going to show it. They're not playing right now because something's derping out of my phone. But they look exactly, the layout, all the buttons, everything. All three of them look near identical. They've all just copied each other, and it is the attention wars. So anyway, I feel like I really got into the rants today. 226. I've been going for a long time. Pretty strong. So I think we'll wrap it up there. If there's any final questions, you guys can let me know. That's a weird, it's like Robin Williams or something. If you're interested, highly recommend you request a demo. I might as well put that thing in the chat for those that are interested. And if you get on there and you talk to somebody and you're like, this is awesome, I'm definitely signing up. These people are super cool. They know what they're talking about. You will get the Reels inclusion, of course, if you sign up between now, I think, is it Tuesday? Yeah, I think it's Tuesday. What was I going to do? Ah, I know. Demo request. I should have these links ready. Normally I have someone help me on these things, and it's just, they're just there. Boom, boom, boom. All right, so I'm gonna throw that in the chat. You can fill out that form that's in the chat, and somebody will contact you, follow up with you, show you the demo. You can decide. For everyone else, I will send you the replay. All the bells and whistles and things that we talked about from a content standpoint will all be in there. Or hope to see you on a future session. Run these from time to time. A lot of times people will come back. It's very, very flattering. But other than that, you know, happy Friday. Great weekends all. Appreciate you guys sticking with me. Happy birthday, Carolyn. There was one other happy birthday. I can't remember who it was. It was at the very, very top. Did she leave? Oh, and Wendy. Happy birthday, Wendy, on here. So we always got to shout out the birthdays. Yeah, hope you guys all have a great weekend. Hope to see you on the inside. Hope you enjoyed it. Do not let pricing destroy you. Okay. And hope to see you around in the future. Bye, guys. Oh, a crush.